So today I'm going to take you on a virtual tour of the Linux file system, but it's a little bit of a weird tour because there's a lot of things in the Linux file system that are there because they've been there for a long time and may not make sense anymore, but it's still important to know about them because if you're going to use Linux, that's where stuff still is. So let's go find stuff. I'll explain some stuff along the way and we'll learn just how strange of a beast Linux can really be. So the first thing I want to show you is just a couple commands that'll kind of set the stage for what we're looking at. First is the free command. Now we can also do free-h for human readable. And what this does is just show us our current memory, like how much memory is on the system. So up here is in blocks, not quite as easy to read. And then down here, we see that this computer has about 2 gigabytes of RAM, and there is about 5 or 659 megabytes used and that many free, and some is buffered, some's in cache. There's also a swap file that is just about 1 gigabyte in size, and some of that is used as well. So this is just where you can look to see how much RAM is used on the system. But if you want to look at what's using that RAM, the ps command is a very popular way, or a very good way, to see what's running. But by default, it'll just show you the things that you're currently running, your user. For example, I'm in a bash shell and I'm running ps. So generally what we do is do something like ps dash AUX, and this changes and people use different flags. I don't think I need the dash anymore. I think it's just AUX, and it'll give me all of the running commands on the system, including the user that is actually running them. So a lot of times if I'm looking for a particular running piece of software, I will grep for it. Now we know the grep tool pretty well. So let's look for something that's running and I'll show you what it would look like. So the cron daemon. So let's do come on, go away. I don't know why that's still there. There we go. Let's clear the screen. So PS AUX, and then I'm going to grep for the word cron. And that will show us the things that are currently running on the system that have the word cron in them. For example, user sbin cron, this is the root user running our cron daemon. And also this annoying thing, it showed my grep for cron, which is super annoying, but nonetheless, it showed that that command is being run by Sean. And so we can look at commands like that. If you want to look at interactively what's going on, just run the top command. And this will actually show us all the stuff that we've looked at already. We can see our current memory, 1.9 gigabytes, and how much is free, how much is used, all that stuff along with the swap. We can also see how much CPU is currently in use. And if you look down here, you can see all of the running processes on the system. By default, it sorts by the CPU usage. So the highest CPU process is going to sort to the top. So it's sorted by this by default. But if you do the left and right greater than symbols, like let's do a greater than as opposed to the less than. So the one that's pointing to the right, the greater than symbol, it will sort by the next column to the right, or the memory. And you can see now these are all sorted by current memory usage. And the highest memory usage program on the system right now is the X Windows or X Org, and it's using 7.8% of our system memory. And so this is an interactive way to look at the various processes, and here are those PIDs. Now I keep mentioning these because these are going to be important. The process ID is the process identifier on the system. This is how Linux knows the process that's running. It numbers each one. So press Q to get out of top. And now that we understand enough about processes and how to see what's running and understand that they're correlated to a process ID, let's talk a little bit about virtual file systems. Because while we have a hard drive that actually has physical files on it, there's also what's called a virtual file system, actually several of them, on a Linux system. Now, one that we've looked at before is the dev file system. What's inside here, things like dev SDA for like the first serial ATA hard drive, these are not actual files. They are device nodes. So again, dev SDA means the actual physical hard drive, and it's a way that we can interact with that hardware on the command line. So Linux interacts with things as if they are files, and it does that by using this virtual file system. And inside the dev folder, we have a whole bunch of device nodes that are actually pointers to the physical hardware underneath, and that's how we interact with them. Now, another virtual file system is the proc file system. So slash proc. And now the idea here is this is a running tally of all those processes that are running on the system. All those PIDs, all the information about those processes are inside the proc folder. I'll show you what it looks like in just a second. But here's something that happened and is a little bit frustrating. The proc file system is very useful for doing that. However, over the years, a lot of other stuff got crammed in the proc folder. Other kernel information, like about networking stuff and virtual memory and all sorts of other things, were also crammed into the proc file system, but it made it very difficult because the proc system got super full and complicated. So the idea was, you know what? All that should be in there is process information. So why don't we make a brand new virtual file system and call it /sys. And that can be where all of the other kernel stuff that's not process related gets created, because these are all dynamic, right? They're not actual files. They're created and they're virtual. They're created on the fly when the system boots up. And so why don't we just put all that other stuff in sys? The problem is nobody really did that because it was already in proc, and why do it over again? So now there's some stuff that lives in the sys folder, a lot of stuff that still lives in the proc folder. Some of it was moved over, not all of it was moved over. So it's kind of a mess, and you just have to kind of look everywhere to see that information. But those are the virtual file systems. Again, dev we're already familiar with, but let's check it out real quick and you'll be able to see kind of what the mess I'm talking about. So let's clear this. Now, again, we're just going to look inside the dev folder, just an ls of dev, and you can see all of these are device nodes, right? They point to things like our hard drives. For example, this is the hard drive that this computer is installed on, and these are the partitions, etc., etc. So all of these are just device nodes, and that's how we interact with it. If we look in the, let's actually go there into the proc system and type ls, we're going to see now all these numbers, these are process IDs. In a perfect world, all the proc folder would hold are these folders. Every folder is a process, and these are the PIDs. So if we were to go into, let's go into folder 79, for instance. If we go in here, this is all the information about that running process 79, okay? And this is all of the information. You see there's lots and lots of information you can get about the running process, because this is literally how Linux and the Linux kernel keep track of running programs. This is all the information about it. But we go back out, we're going to see all this other stuff has nothing to do with processes. This is all just kernel information that was plopped into the proc file system. So if we look at mdstat, for instance, see, this is saying we don't have any RAID devices, which is true, but why would it be inside the proc file system? You'd think that would be inside the sys file system. Let's look at that now. If we look in the sys folder, we're going to see it's organized really well. Again, this was an afterthought, like, hey, let's do everything in here. But unfortunately, all of the stuff isn't necessarily in here. Now, if we do an ls everything, we'll see there is some stuff inside these folders, and it is used. Unfortunately, it's now this hodgepodge of some stuff is in the sys folder, some stuff is in the proc folder. So you have to look both places to find the information that you're looking for. But that is the whole idea behind the virtual file systems, is that Linux treats everything as a file, and it just creates these on the fly, and you can interact with them. So yeah, there's a little bit of oddities when it comes to the virtual file systems, but thank goodness there's also some strangeness when it comes to the actual physical file systems and files stored on the hard drives. It's not too bad, and it just goes back to when hard drives were smaller and the file system was kind of chopped up into pieces, it mattered where things went. Whereas now hard drives are huge, and generally it's just a directory in on the system as opposed to separate hard drives. So I'll show you why, or what the folders are that still exist and why they exist. Now, we have seen before that things in like user bin and bin, these are executable files. Now, the reason there are two different locations, /bin and /userbin, is there used to be a need to separate out the files that were absolutely needed for system rescue. Or like if something went wrong and a hard drive was unmounted, you had to be able to do a few things, like in single user mode, and those critical files or those critical programs were put in the bin folder. And then after the system booted up or when it was running normally, you would have another hard drive mounted in the user USR folder, and in there, there would be a bin folder, and that's where most of your other programs, like your web servers and all that stuff, all of those things would live in user bin as opposed to just the bin folder. And again, it's just because we used to have separate hard drives for all of these folders, and we had to have the very bare minimum required files inside the bin folder. Now, the same exact thing is with sbin and user sbin. These are specifically programs that are used for configuring the system. Generally, only the root user or sudo user will use things in the sbin folder, but it's separated out that way, and they're specifically for configuring the system. And then, of course, user share bin is another location. And again, this used to be another entire hard drive that we could use, this share, this user share hard drive, but now it's just a folder inside the main file system. But here is where programs that are used for other or used by other applications will go in this location. For example, if the Apache web server has to use like a binary plugin, it would probably live in that user share bin folder, and Apache would have access to use it. So that's how they're separated and why they're separated out. To add insult to injury, some distributions actually just make symbolic links, so they're actually all the same folder. So sometimes sbin will link to user sbin or vice versa. So they're not even all that always separated anymore. And that can be frustrating, but understand why they existed that way, and you'll see, you know, why they still exist in some form for kind of backwards compatibility or for backwards understanding, if nothing else. And we're almost done with our tour here. There's a folder called boot. It's just /boot. That's where the actual kernel itself lives. That's where the boot folder is on the hard drive. It can't be in RAID. It has to be on like just a regular partition. And so it's generally stored in a folder called boot. Sometimes that's a separate partition. The etc folder, or etc, this is where all of the configuration files are stored. So all Linux files or all Linux programs use text-based configuration files, and they live inside the etc folder. So it'll be like /etc /like Apache 2 or something. And then there is var log, and this is where, you guessed it, all the log files live. Now, why var? Well, var used to be a really, really big hard drive that you would mount, and it would have things like user mail files would be in there. Anything else that was written too often would go in the var hard drive. But now it's just, you know, usually on the same system or on the same hard drive. But var log is where log files are generally kept. And then one last group that I want to talk about, because you'll see this, even though you might not use it very often, user local. And then inside user local, there's going to be user local bin, user local, etc. Sometimes there'll be user local var as well. And what this is, it's generally where you put locally compiled programs. Like, you didn't install it with the package manager. You actually downloaded the source code and you compiled it with your computer, and you put those binaries in a place like user local bin, and you put the configuration files in user local, etc. And that's just standard practice, so you don't accidentally overwrite something that the package manager on your distribution put in the etc folder. So the last thing I want to show you before we finish up is, if we look in the var log folder, we're going to see there are a bunch of files and some folders. So an application can actually have its own set of log files. Like the cups print server here has its own folder, and inside there, let's look inside the cups directory, it has its own files that it keeps track of, its own logs. However, there is a catch-all that is the syslog program, and different distributions handle it differently. Here in Ubuntu, everything that is captured goes into a file called syslog. So if we tail syslog, we're going to see this is kind of a catch-all of all the different programs dump their logs into syslog. And you can see as things happen, it just keeps getting added to the syslog file, with the exception of the kernel. The kernel actually keeps its own log file, and you see that by typing dmessage. And dmessage will just show you all of the kernel's log files as they happen. So like if you plug in a new USB device, it'll pop up in the dmessage log. And some systems, if we look, some systems actually have a printed out version of the dmessage log, and some of them do not. But what you, if you want to see the real-time running kernel messages, you do dmessage. And you could do something like pipe it through tail if you just want to see the very end of it, and it'll just show you the last entries. But that's the kernel log. Everything else is stored in the syslog. But again, this is distro specific. For example, if we look at a Red Hat based system like Red Hat Enterprise Linux or CentOS, or we're going to look at Rocky Linux, there is no var log syslog file at all. So we're here on Rocky Linux, which is a Red Hat based system. And if we, I'm already in there, I think, let's see, PWD. Yeah, I'm in var log. So if we look, there is no syslog file, even though there is a syslog daemon running. What it does is it dumps everything into a file called var log messages. And you actually have to be root to see this. So sudo tail messages. And here we see this is just like the stuff that would be in syslog on Ubuntu. It's just put into the system here. Now we can also type dmessage, and it's going to do the same thing. This is the kernel log that works the exact same way as it does on Ubuntu. But just know that the syslog might put it in a file called syslog, or it might put it in a file called messages, depending on the distribution that you're using. And last but not least, let's clear the screen. The new way that programs are launched in most distributions is using a system called systemd. Now, systemd does logging differently. We actually have to type journalctl-u for what unit, and let's look at the cron log. And this actually shows us the cron daemon's log, but it is not stored anywhere. It's actually kept in binary form, and you have to use the journalctl program to actually see it. But because of backwards compatibility, and there's so many like systems out there, what Ubuntu does is it uses journalctl, but it also writes all of the same stuff to syslog. So it lives in both places. In the future, you probably will not be able to find all the stuff in a written log file. You'll probably have to use journalctl in order to see those files. So it's really good to understand that log files are going binary, and they're not just going to be dumped into text files in your var log folder. Using journalctl isn't that difficult, but it's really important to know that if stuff is still written in your var log folder, it might just be for backwards compatibility's sake, and that might go away in the future. Anyway, I know this is a lot to digest, but the Linux file system isn't just files, it's the virtual file system as well. But knowing all that stuff will make you that much better when it comes to using Linux on a day-to-day basis. Remember, learn everything, do what you love, and most importantly, be kind. I hope you enjoyed this video. It really was chock full of information. And if you'd like me to cover more stuff about the file system, or if you have any other ideas you'd like me to cover in future videos once we get done with this Linux Essentials series, just let me know. Put it right in the comments. I read every comment, every single one, unless it's in another language. And then I try to read it, and maybe Google Translate will read it, and then I'll read what Google Translate. Anyway, leave a comment below, like and subscribe and all that stuff, and I'll see you at the next video.